are here celebrating today our Black History Month in our service, where we celebrate those especially who have had some pioneering feats that they have done, especially in the African American community, where extraordinary feats and achievement has been done to forward the rights, civil rights of that community. And we had such a wonderful presentation from our children, our young people. And so I just want to go down in that vein a little bit today about the whole aspect of fighting for the underprivileged, for looking out for the disadvantaged, especially in the African American community. When we talk about, as we discuss today with our young people, we everyone knows Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. and his civil rights struggles and achievements. And Rosa Parks, as we look about in her defiance not to go to the back of the bus, so as to not to continue and forward the aims of an oppressive, discriminative system. And we see also Frederick Douglass. I'm going to talk about him and his academic prowess. He was actually the first African American to be nominated to the vice presidency of the United States. He became vice president, but he was nominated to run on the ticket to be vice president. And we also look at Harriet Tubman and her Underground Railroad moving slaves from the South, trying to get them to the North, and helping the Union Army to defeat the Confederates. She acted as a spy, and her struggles. And we see the struggles of these individuals, Langston Hughes, and we see where the Civil Rights Movement was brought out of the death, the killing, the murder of Emmett Till, a young 14-year-old from the Chicago area. And so forth. And we see Sojourner Truth. Some talked about her today in her tried to be an abolitionist of slavery and segregation and her struggle. And see how she struggled. You change her name to become a Sojourner, because she was always sojourning and moving from place to place and speaking truth. And so she changed her name to Sojourner Truth, the truth teller. And how she was bought as property, as a slave, as a property of a slave owner. I think it was for $10 or something of that price. A human being auction-like livestock. This is a system that a lot of African American, our ancestors, has been brought up into. But when we talk about Black history is not defined based on the history of Black people here in the United States. Our Black history goes beyond the diaspora, the American diaspora of us being here. Hallelujah! It's not just coming from slave ships. From primarily West Africa, West Central Africa, but our journey begins more. And we read in the scripture today, in Psalms of Solomon, where Solomon was writing his love letter to his beloved, his lover, his wife, one of his many wives, and he talks about, "I am black." He's talking about Solomon, the richest man that ever lived, the wisest man outside of Jesus Christ that has ever lived. Hallelujah. We're talking about that person seeing himself, he was black. Hallelujah. So there's a lot of history that has been distorted about the blacks and it has been deliberately done so as not to give people any credence within their own culture and their own race. Hallelujah. And when I say race, because there's only one race, there's the human race. Hallelujah. A black person is not from a different species, or a white, or a blue, or a pink. It's the same species of humanity. So there's no race, as it were, just one human race. Hallelujah. But we know that this racism is a social construct that was placed upon a system so as to subjugate one people by another. Hallelujah. To keep one people down, to show that they are nothing, because I'm going to enslave you. You are nothing. You are just like probably without a soul. And that's why when we talk about even Frederick Douglass, and we discuss this, that he actually see how can people become Christian. And that's why a lot of people have issues with Christianity. Hallelujah. The Muslim has an issue with Christianity, because you preach a Christ that is love, but you behave contrary to that Christ. Hallelujah. And so Christianity, Christ, is not always showed up in Christianity by our doings. And sometimes you see the system of government and system of oppression by certain governments. And this is not endemic only to the United States. Hallelujah. A lot of those systems that brought slave here to the Americas was done by Europeans. And some of them, when you look at the history of slavery, from African slavery, a lot of them was done by Arabs. A lot of people don't know that. And so we're not just blaming one group of people. And if you look and see even further history of civilization, one of the earliest civilizations, if not the earliest civilization, were the Egyptian. And the Egyptians were African. And now Africans, they may look different now. Hallelujah. But back then they were black, as the scripture talks about, and Ethiopians and so forth. And then the first civilization, they were black and they were in charge. And they themselves enslaved. We see this in scripture. The Egyptian enslaved the Israelites. So the cycle changes. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. One, and so that's why you have to be careful. You have to be careful who is down now, because the tables might just turn, and you know who are the oppressor now become the oppressed, the oppressee. Hallelujah, if I may say. And so you have to be careful how you characterize people, how you treat people. Hallelujah. You have to be extremely careful of how you treat people, because what the person, hallelujah, the person that seems to be down now may sometime become maybe up next time. And so we have to be understanding that people situation change. Hallelujah. A situation change, because as I said, before you had slavery in North America and in the Americas, hallelujah, you also had the first slavery by black Egyptian of Eastern, or you can call the Middle Eastern, the Israelites. And so the first set of people who had power and had domination of the earth, hallelujah, also were blacks. And so you see, there are times, centuries, and sometimes it is said that the lifespan of an empire generally, not all the time, but generally lasts about two centuries. Hallelujah. The lifetime of an empire, or a dominant culture, dominant, hallelujah. And you see that even in Egyptian culture, they came on the scene, and then they thought that, oh, we're going to be the greatest ever, or the black culture, we're going to be the greatest ever, and they dominate the culture and rule, and the Egyptian rule. But another culture came on there. Another culture came onto the scene. You had the Assyrian culture rise up over time, and they became the dominant culture, and they ruled from Babylon, and then there another stuff people came after that. Hallelujah. The Babylonian culture came up after the Assyrian. We have Nebuchadnezzar, and after that, the Persian people. Hallelujah. We're seeing Iran right now, and they dominate. So one time, the Middle East were the dominant people. The Middle East, and not just the West, the Middle East. And even people can say, you know what, the Chinese were even more dominant before that. In their dynasty, in their time, hallelujah. And so one group, hallelujah, rule and subjugate another group and become, and you have oppression and division, hallelujah. And so right now we're in, what's it called, the emerging century, American century. And we have been a country, hallelujah, for 230 years now. And so we are basically have come to the maturation of our culture, of tourism. 200 years, but we really became world leaders mainly around World War II. After World War II, after England was a dominant force, and the bad hand, they said the Kingdom of the Commonwealth of England, the British Empire, was so vast that when the sun rise up to the sun going down, because they would dominate China and India and dominate the West and the Americas. Hallelujah. But what? They thought that their culture would probably live the longest and outlast all the culture. But what? The American culture came in. And so now Americans are the greatest, and we are exceptional. Hallelujah. But that's how other cultures back in the back. That's how Rome thought that they were the greatest and the ever. But someone came and conquer them and dominate them. And so by seeing that, you have to be careful who you treat now, because the person who you think you can put your foot on their head and dominate is gonna not be tomorrow, but 50 years, 100 years from now, the turn may change. The table will turn. You have to understand that. Hallelujah. That some God raise up one and put down another. And the one that he raise up is going to be put down, and you're going to be under subjugation. So you be careful how you treat people. Because the person who you see on the roadside begging for bread and in a destitute situation, 10 years down the line, he may be hiring you at his job. Hallelujah. That child may be taking care of you on your deathbed. Hallelujah. You have to be careful how you treat God's people. Hallelujah. So here we turn to the scriptures. And I actually turn to Luke chapter 16. Luke chapter 16. And we have two characters in the scriptures. Two characters. In Luke chapter 16. And verse 19 says, "And there was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple." Hallelujah. So when he's a rich. So we see a rich individual. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The Bible referred to him as Dives. Hallelujah. A rich man that dressed in purple. Hallelujah. He went to Nordstrom. Hallelujah. He went to Macy's. Ralph Lauren's, and of all the latest garments. Hallelujah. And he was rich. He lives in a penthouse. Hallelujah. And so we see this character. Look at how situation is. Because you have in our culture. Hallelujah. Come on, just want you to pay attention to me, kids. We have in a culture that people have short memories. Hallelujah. Especially even in the black, hallelujah, culture. Because we want to talk to especially black people today. Because sometimes we talk about Black History Month. We want to say, the problem in our community is only and mainly the white man. Hallelujah. And yes, he may have this issue, but right now, hallelujah, sometimes the very more problem we have, because David said, you know what offend me? If it was my somebody who stabbed me in the back, it's not my enemy. It's not those who I knew that was afar off, but someone who was familiar to me, even my family, my friend, my closest friend. And sometimes some of the biggest hindrance to people and to black struggle is black people themselves. Hallelujah. Us, we, and sometimes we have to understand why are we, hallelujah, so not progressive. And when I say progressive, I'm talking about politics now. I'm talking about why are we not, hallelujah, allowing ourselves, hallelujah, to see the plight of others. Because most of us came out of the same barren. Hallelujah. Only very few blacks in this country, hallelujah, were actually born with in a gold spoon. Even if you in your generation had dwelt, and probably your father and your grandparents didn't, hallelujah, they struggled, hallelujah, they, most of them, if not all of them, even if you came from a different country, hallelujah, they were somehow oppressed, hallelujah, I have some history of slavery, and some history of oppression. Hallelujah. If you come from Africa, and you come from South Africa, there was oppression and apartheid, you come from some country that was actually ruled by black governments, hallelujah, but there still was oppression and tribal wars. And so some of us, so the black experience was born out of sorrow and struggle, for the better part of for most of us. There in America, in the West Indies, Caribbean, and even Africa, from the African diaspora. But what I like to understand, that I know that we come from some suffering, and you should understand where I'm coming from, and we're the person that don't have little, you should understand where it's coming from, because you also came and your ancestors came from meager beginning. But we have some people of short memories, that because they have something now, they want to leave, and they don't want to despise those that don't have. And so you have the haves and the have not in the black community, and that now seems to be a problem. And so here Jesus now is talking about a parable. And when Jesus talks about parables, he always put it in a context of the people that he's talking about. So it's normally, because talking to Jews, it always tend to be around a Jewish culture and a Jewish way of life and system. Hallelujah. And so here he says here, you have a rich man that was dressed in purple in Luke chapter 16:19, and in fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day. So he was wealthy, and he had food, and just eating, and just drive the latest model vehicle, and just living high. And I just want to picture this in a black context, and that you have now some people now who have matriculated out of the ghetto, out of the wood, as you may, out of the inner city. God has favored them, and they have gotten an education, and they went to the Ivy League schools, and they got a piece of paper, hallelujah, a camel skin, hallelujah, and they have the degrees, and now, when they were in city situation, and living in the projects, they were on food stamps, and they benefited from food stamps, and they benefited from the social programs that was there to help people who didn't have it all, who was suffering, who was hurting. And now that you now have it all, and now that you have your education, and you have your corner office, and you have your government job, hallelujah, yes, because most blacks in the middle class government jobs, hallelujah, yeah, because that's where only few matriculate into corporate Wall Street environment and do real excellent. But when you go to the DMV and all these state-run enterprises, state government and all of those enterprises and the federal government, that's where a lot of blacks in the upper echelons and their socioeconomic and educated blacks lands, hallelujah. And now, hallelujah, you benefited from the blessing and suffering of others, and now that you reach to some place, then you want to despise the wood. food. And one of the spies, everyone said, why don't he pick up himself by the bootstrap? And so here we have in this parable, hallelujah, this man was rich and feared sumptuous. He dressed pretty and looked good and eat good every day. And he says here, and dear, and there's another man now. And let's meet our other character. Hallelujah. There was a certain beggar named Lazarus. So here we have a rich man, and then we have a beggar. Therefore, he was poor. Not he was dirt poor, that he lived. He did not have a house. He was homeless. Hallelujah. Did not have nothing to eat. Couldn't go to the grocery store and purchase his meal, his groceries for the week. Hallelujah. No. He couldn't feel sumptuously like Diabetes, the rich man. Hallelujah. He was in tattered, in rags by the corner. And so he was a beggar named Lazarus. Hallelujah. Which was, hallelujah, laid at the gate, hallelujah, of the rich man. And he was full of sores. So he was sick and put up out of leprosy, of all the sickness and disease. And someone may say to him, like the rich man and so many people, oh, look at that man. Look at that lazy black man. Hallelujah. Don't want to go work. Don't want, hallelujah. Oh, look at the sores. Hallelujah. The government shouldn't take care of him. I should have no health care for him because, you know, no, because I have my premium plan. But this man couldn't go and get to the doctor to receive any cure. Hallelujah. So some people sometimes judge him. And that's why we see people in the black community judging other, hallelujah, other of lower sort of situation. Not knowing that, hallelujah, if but for the grace of God, that could be you. Hallelujah. That, hallelujah, 20 years before, that could be you. Hallelujah. Knowing that sometimes our forefathers were beggars and destitute. Hallelujah. But I come to tell you, turn to the neighbor, say, the tables will turn. Hallelujah. Turn to your neighbors. I'm telling you, the tables will turn. You see, I want to tell somebody here, justice don't always happen in this life. No. Sometimes we say, God, how can the evil reign? How can people do bad and seem to prosper? And they seem to get away with it. They never go to jail when they steal. But if the beggar steal a loaf of bread to eat, he's locked up for 10 years. But if the rich man, the Wall Street guy, I will take to steal a $2 million and rent people's pension, he get a slap on the wrist or even nothing. Wall Street, hallelujah, those people who brought down the house and the mortgage and housing crisis, millions lost their jobs, but not one man went to jail. Hallelujah. Robbery, highway robbery, hallelujah, but they feel sumptuously. But watch them dogs, because they might not face the God, the judgment now, but judgment is coming. Be careful how you treat God's people, because you see them low now, watch them, because God is going to turn the table. And so here we see Lazarus at the rich man's gate with sores, full of sores. And verse 20 says, and there was, hallelujah, verse 21 says, and desiring to be fed, he was hungry. Lazarus was hungry, and he wanted to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and lick his sores. That was his health care. He could no. They didn't provide the government or whatever society to take care of him. Then dogs, and this is what some people say, I have my money in my pocket, and you know what? I don't care about anybody else. I climbed the ladder, and since I reached the upper echelon, I'm not going to kick the ladder down. I don't care about you. Hallelujah. And especially, I just come content. mind. You see that especially amongst blacks. I see in the Jewish community, Jews will build and lift up other Jews and provide and make a way and employment opportunities. I see this among the Chinese community. They will make they come together and band as a community. You have China towns and of China village, Indian village, Hispanic, hallelujah, supermarket and area, hallelujah, and they work well together and build their community. But what about blacks? We all just must tear down each other, because what I got mine, I am the haves, and you are the have not. I don't care about you. I don't care about you getting health care. I don't care about, hallelujah, the man fighting unjust wars, veterans, and they come here and they are homeless and they sleep on the streets. But as long as we go tend them to kill young Iraqi babies and Vietnam children and use them and take up their precious youths and destroy their lives and their mental abilities and physical prowess, we discard them as a society. Hallelujah. Watch them. Because you know what? And guess what? I said, well, we are paying our taxes. We should use tax money to take care of those scums. But listen to me. Most of those people, hallelujah, don't pay taxes. The rich, the super rich, find a way not to pay taxes. And so, you and I, the middle class, are the one who's footing the bill for them to drive their Hummer and their Beamer and their Bentleys, and we are providing for them to get security, and they get good security, but they don't pay for it. Hallelujah, it's the middle class. Hallelujah, because they find a way to do tax loopholes and tax write-offs. Hallelujah, but they don't want you to benefit from the state, while they benefit all from the state. And I'm preaching here. Hallelujah. Maybe too high for you, but I'm going down that road. Tell to turn to him and say, the tides are turning. The tides are turning. You may be on top now, but look out. Hallelujah. Even not in this life, but there's a price coming for your hate and your division and your wickedness. Hallelujah. 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 David saw it. And David cries out in the Psalms. How can the wicked, how can the evil man in Psalms 37? I see, hallelujah, evil men, they just blossom up. And their life seems to be good. The grass seems to be greener on the other side. But I come to tell you, that grass may not be real grass. It may be astroturf. Hallelujah. It may be a camouflage. Because I'm telling you, the tides are turning. Hallelujah. God, rise up one and put down another. Be careful. Step over someone and step upon them and trample them. Because you may be trampling your hope. You may be trampling your dreams. You may be trampling the next doctor, the next lawyer, the next president. Be careful how you treat God's people. And God's people is everybody. Hallelujah, that calls upon God. Hallelujah, everyone. God loves everybody. Every people of the earth, hallelujah, is his people. They may not be the children of God, but it's his people. Hallelujah, in terms of his creation. And we must not mistreat God's creation. If we want to take care of the butterflies, and we're going to say, oh, the butterflies and the elephants is an endangered species, and we can't do anything about that. And that elephant and that lion and that tiger and that bald eagle don't have a soul, but you want to trample over God's precious soul, that human being, you have a sad day coming, very sad. And so here I'm talking now about Lord Jesus, about this beggar. Hallelujah, he wanted the crumbs. You see, that's what some, hallelujah, the enemy, hallelujah, of social justice, the rich just want to give you crumbs, the trickle-down effect. Whatever I eat and the leftover, then you can get it. And that's what some people have. Some people don't even want to get the crumbs. Hallelujah. Don't want to get, you're getting all the benefits from society. Corporate bailout. Hallelujah. You're getting your six-figure salary. Some seven, eight figures. Hallelujah. You're getting it. You're getting it, all the blessings of the state. The state government, the federal government. Hallelujah. You are chauffeur driven. You never drive in the last 10 years. Your own vehicle. You get the best. You get free meals. God care of the government, the court, the taxpayers. The poor mother going to work at 7 at 6 o'clock and scrubbing toilets, and she's paying your taxes. Hallelujah. You sit up in those state houses. You sit up and get those pensions and get those benefits and get those health care and get a salary. Care of that poor lady in the working class neighborhood that can't afford, hallelujah, to shop. But your taxes is taking care of you. But you don't seek to earn interest. No. You don't seek to forward the interest of the poor. But the rich man who don't pay the tax, who find a way to ship his money to Cayman Islands, to ship it to Panama. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's who you take care of. His money don't touch the shores of the U.S. But you cater to his interests. And you fatten his pocket. But there's a day coming. There's a day of reckoning coming. Hallelujah to God. And we have to understand, because Jesus is talking in the scripture, the tides are turning. Hallelujah to God. And so in verse 22 here, in hallelujah, in Luke chapter 16, and it says, and it came to pass that the beggar died. Somebody say died. It's promised unto man once to die, and what come after? The judgment. Yes. You think you're gonna live forever? No. You evade the cops. The cops didn't find out that you embezzled all that money from the pensions of the teachers and the pensions of the poor, and you go into the social security trust fund and you take all that money and give it for tax cuts and give it to the rich that they didn't even pay taxes, but they want to get the cut. Hallelujah. Yes. But there's a day of reckoning coming, because you see what, you may abscond jail, you may get a skirt around prison, you may evade the American justice system, but you know what, you will not evade death. Yes, every man is going to find death. I say Lazarus the beggar died, and so the rich man is also going to die, and that's the common denominator to every man, black, white, pink, purple, hallelujah, orange, hallelujah, magenta, whatsoever your color. You know what? You're going to die, and you're going to face your maker, and you have to give an account of what you've done. And if you live wicked,
I know.
You're going to find out. And look at it now. Look at what happened to the beggar. Look at what happened to the poor man. The man that was living in the woods. The man that was living was a homeless veteran. Hallelujah. The black man. The family that was sleeping out of their car because they have been evicted. And there was no Section 8 because the government decided to cut it. Yes. Because guess what? That's what you have in our country, and that's what you had in slavery days. You know what? I, as a white man, not going to punish the black slaves or the black field slaves. So what I do is get a bookie master. I get another black strong man and feed him good and put him in a little cot close
to the house, make him a house slave. And what you do, you get, now you use him, hallelujah, to brutalize the other weaker field slaves. Because they, no, the other one is doing all the labor. But you use him to whip and to scourge. And this is what is happening. Look at what is happening. You have now an incoming administration. One of the first things that they did, while hours into the new administration of this president, and while I may applaud him for talking about religious liberties and talking about bringing back Christmas, hallelujah, into the stores, but if I can't afford money to go to the stores, I don't care how much Christmas signs you have up. That's not going to benefit me. But look at what happened. What he does now, the person who's homeless and who is in Section 8 and don't have nowhere to live, what he does now, first thing he did is remove the FHA cut that was promised to FHA loans. Poor people that took out FHA loans, and they were going to cut the rate. And then now, that's the first order of business is to sustain that cut, so that people who have mortgage will not get any relief. And what they do now is appoint or nominate someone, another black man, over the house. I was in an urban, hallelujah, development agency. Why? Because to go fix HUD and fix the black community? No. It's to cut subsidies. It's to cut food. Section 8. Watch them dogs. You think that they're going to come to do anything better for the blacks? No, they use another black and give it up, put a black face on it. Just like the bookie master. He put a house slave in the Housing Development Corporation. To what? To cut subsidies to urban area. And so when you can't point finger and say, it's the white man doing it. No, but it's a black man. He's a secretary of honor. And say, can't point finger. But I tell you, it's coming. Wickedness in high places. And so here we have, hallelujah, people. But we're going to all die. But God, you're going to face the judgment. You might have faced the judge at the circuit court or the appeals judge. You might have faced that judge because you may have the money to pay them off. And you curry favor and you use your color or you use your class. Your class warfare. Hallelujah, to get away. But you're going to face another judge. The real judge. The judge, the true judge of mankind. And so here we see, hallelujah to God, hallelujah, the beggar died and was what? Carried. Lazarus the beggar died and was escorted up, hallelujah, by the angels into Abraham's bosom. And so here, yes, he didn't have it all well in this life. And so why do you think that, I get it good now, and you are nobody. But look at it, the tables is turning. This beggar, this man, believed on God, though he was poor. That's why I come to tell you, the blacks in this country are one of the most spiritual, hallelujah, groups in this country. Part of the prosperity of this country is because of the spirituality and the worshiping. Even when they were whipped and slaved and hung and lynched, they would sing, we shall overcome. Hallelujah. To sing the Negro spiritual. Hallelujah. Praising God. Even by whipped. Even when there was scourge. Even when they saw their husband hung from a tree. Yet they worship God. And but they might beat them and kill them. But they were escorted by the angels into heaven. Yes, Lord. Because they serve our wonderful God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to God. We shall overcome. And so he went into Abraham's bosom. Because back in the Old Testament, Testament, he had a covenant, the promise was made unto Abraham. And so once you believe unto God, it was based on the Abrahamic covenant. And so he was escorted by angels. But what? He didn't. You look and see that. We don't even know that he was buried. But look at what took place with the rich man. And it says here, and the rich man, hallelujah, doth also die. Somebody say also.
Also.
You want to also face the life of everybody. You can get all your Medicaid and all your Blue Cross Blue Shields platinum plans that you want, but you shall die. You also shall die. Hallelujah. The man who didn't get in, who you take off from Obamacare, Medicare. I didn't want to give them Medicare, Medicaid. Hallelujah. Then you know what? He will die because he didn't get medical assistance. But you know what? All the medicine that is there, you also shall die. You may die at a later age, as it seems here. The rich man died after Lazarus. Hallelujah. You may die up in your 80s and these poor people die in their 50s because they don't get Medicare, but you know what? You still die. I will meet your maker. And this is what happened. And the rich man also died and was buried. Somebody say, and was buried. It is interesting. Don't overlook scripture because it's very important. It didn't say Lazarus was buried. He probably, they just cast his body in the dump heap. He didn't get a proper funeral service because nobody came and identified the body. And he was tossed before. And they probably put him like in Cook County jail to hundreds of people without no ID, just die. And they probably cremate the body or dispose of the body in some beggar's plot. Hallelujah. And so he was discarded. But look at it. His soul was escorted up into heaven by angel. But the rich man who feared sumptuously every day, what? He got a funeral procession. He was buried. His friends, his family put out formal arrangement for him. And they probably gave him a platinum casket made of titanium. If there's such a thing of a casket, hallelujah. They had police escort take the body from the church to the burial spot, and they may lay him in a grave and put marble tomb and write his name. Wonderful. He was buried. The people wept and the people made tributes. He probably got a state funeral. He was buried. He looks good. People speak wonderful thing about him. Oh, wonderful divers. He probably donated to this group so as to get a tax write-off and so forth. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He may basically have done all of that. But look at what. Hallelujah. Look at her and what happened. Hallelujah. Verse 23. And in hell, here it says, he didn't go to Abraham's bosom. The angel didn't escort him to heaven. Where did he land in? In hell. So with all of that flamboyancy and every wonderful burial he got, he ended up in hell. In a place of torment. In a place of anguish. You notice? The tables has turned. You notice? The tides had turned. It has turned that now the beggar, now the oppressed, now the blacks, now the poor Hispanics, now the people who you discard and tell them, get out of our country. You don't belong here. You don't come. Get out of our neighborhood. Hallelujah. This is a gated community. Hallelujah. This is, don't you see the sign? Hallelujah. Because not only you have racism, a race conflict, but it's a class conflict.
Because as I said, some of the issue is not amongst black and white. It's amongst black and black. Hallelujah. Another type of black and black crime is not a young man, a 15-year-old young man in Chicago gunning down another young man over drugs or some or foolishness. It's the crime of well-off, affluent blacks in this country who God, through the sweat and tears of mother and others, and they got an opportunity. Not that they were brighter than anyone else, because a lot of brains and skills and gifts are still in the wood. But they didn't get the opportunity. You somehow get the opportunity, and you may have matriculated out of the hood. Because of the grace of God and a stroke of luck. And here you are, and you said, oh, I got up here by my own doing. I earned myself. I go to work. I did this. I did that. And you said, well, you could do it. But he didn't give the opportunity. You could do that, but you're not. You are taking from him the safety net. We should cut a student loan, and we should do away with certain programs. And yet you say that he must be helped. How can he be helped? How can he put up himself by this bootstrap? And he probably don't have a boot. But here we see here the rich man. What? He died and went to hell. And he lifted up his eyes, being in torment, and seeing Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in the flames. In these flames, the tables have turned. That one, while you were having it good here, while you were living and partying and enjoying the fat of the land here, at the expense of others. Not, God is not against riches. God is not against you having a little blessing and having something in your pocket. But that blessing must be a blessing to others. Hallelujah. When your cup runs over, make sure it runs into someone and bless someone. Hallelujah. Make sure that you give and you be a blessing to others. Hallelujah. Make sure that the ladder that you climbed on, it is there for somebody to climb on also. You don't push it down and let people just squander and like crumbs in a barrel. God says, you may get away with this in this life, but the judge is going to show up. Hallelujah. Hell awaits those who do hellish things on earth. God don't put anyone in hell. You, by your works, are you not accepting Christ, decide to go to hell by choosing to do wrong and not choosing Christ. Someone said the tables have turned. Hallelujah. The tables have turned. And so as I finish here, but I want you to see this section here, because it is important that I show you this aspect of the scripture. And it says, hallelujah, in verse, hallelujah. He's tormented in the flame. Hallelujah. Verse 27. Then he said, pray thee therefore, Father Abraham, that thou wouldest send him to my father's house. For I have five brethren. I have five other brothers. Hallelujah. That they may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. And Abraham said unto him, they have Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they shall repent. And he said unto him, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they be persuaded through one rose from the dead. So as I finish up here, I want to make a statement. Hallelujah. A dead man speaking from the grave is saying, go and tell my rich brethren, my rich friends, about this place of torment. That they don't come to hell. And Abram is saying in this parable, no, they have the preachers. They have Moses, they have the prophets, and that was under the Old Testament law. But they don't have Jesus and the apostles and the prophets and the teachers and the saints of God in this dispensation to tell you that don't come here. Because some people, as the Bible says, even if someone comes from the dead, they will never hear the preacher. Because they're destined to do wrong. And they want to continue their wicked ways on this earth. But I'm here to tell you as I close the book. Hallelujah. That Lazarus don't have to come from the grave, the dead, in this case, in this parable. Hallelujah. To tell you that Jesus is the answer. The preacher man here is telling you that Jesus is the answer. And you see, you notice in the scripture, he's telling Abraham to tell Lazarus to go and dip the tip of his finger. Again, he's in hell, but he still sees Lazarus as a servant. He still sees Lazarus as an errand boy. Hallelujah. But there's a gulf, as the scripture said, between heaven and hell. How you might can see across the abyss, but I can't. He cannot come to you, and I come to you, because there is no repentance in hell. There's no quenching of the water of your thirst in hell. And so, my admonition as I close, especially to those of us even in the African American community, is that don't kick, hallelujah, the bucket that fed you. Don't kick the social problem. Don't kick against God's people. Hallelujah. Jesus said to Paul when he was on his way to Damascus to kill God's people, to persecute God's people with documents, letters of writing to persecute them. Jesus said to Paul, Saul at that time, Saul of Tarsus, why dost thou persecute us me? Me? I'm not persecuting you, God. I'm persecuting these Christians. They call themselves Christians, these saints. Jesus, when you persecute God's people, whoever they are, you're persecuting God. When you look down and trample on them and take away benefits and take away opportunities from them, hallelujah, you might get away with it in this world. But there's a day of reckoning coming. Learn not to trample upon people that are already trampled upon and down. Don't hit the man while he's down. Don't hit her while she's wobbling. Hallelujah. Even you do that in terms of sports and boxing. You say, he's down. Leave him. He's down. Why go against people who are struggling and suffering and hurting and taking whatever little safety net and whatever blessing and say, you work for it. Everything that you have, you didn't work for it. Hallelujah. Especially people who are born with a gold spoon in their mouth, and some people who inherited your father was a crook and robbery and robbed people to get that money. You look on the railway barons of in 200 years ago, they were crooks. Hallelujah. They wear jacket and suit, but they were white collar thieves and crooks. Steal people, embezzle fund, and to accumulate that wealth. They don't want to pay their workers sufficient money or funds. And the Bible talks about not paying the worker. He is just for his hire. You want to give him? You must have wonderful $1 million CEO pay, and yet you're having people living off the scraps, the scrums, $5 an hour, $7.25 an hour, an hour, while you're making trillions, gazillions of dollars, doing nothing, sitting in a
a corner. I'm going out to play golf. And you see they work hard. Some of the most hardest working people in this country are the poorest. So don't let people give you about hard working. The laborers have worked hard and break their backs to work, and they come home to their husband and to their wives smelly and dusty or whatever. I just work living in an apartment, and but they work hard. And so hard work is not what that allow most people to live to prosper in this country. A lot of it is favors and curry fee, and I know you and so forth and handle, and you give your friend this and political back slapping, and you I put you in this so you can benefit me. Hallelujah. Corruption. And but God says there's a day coming when there's a count will be given. Hallelujah. And that's why we as people of God, as you stand, we as people, is that we are not, some of us is not going to get our things here. Don't expect all your blessings. Black people, oppressed people, Hispanic people, Muslim people, and some white poor people, or whatever you are, red, yellow, whatever, you might not get the blessings now on this earth. Don't wait on the blessings that are always here on earth. But when you die, you serve God, you bless God, you honor God with your life, you serve God, you lift up God. You might not get an expensive a funeral service and be sent off, hallelujah, in posh cemeteries and get a police escort. But your soul, your spirit will be escorted, will be carried into the bosom of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You will be blessed. You will inherit eternal life and the blessing of God because you trust God until you die. Eternal God and Father, thank you, Jesus. God, you lift up one and you place on some. God, some become lead, sometimes the head become the tail and the tail become the head. God, Lord Jesus, sometimes the last shall become first and the first last. Hallelujah. So that's why, God, we must love all people everywhere. Lord Jesus, we must love everyone always. And so, God, we thank you, Jesus, that, God, as you put the scripture, God, to us today about the rich man and the poor man, Lazarus. And you see their parallel lives, hallelujah, of how one lived, oh God, luxuriantly in this life, but didn't have love, and didn't have God, and oh, how he hit hell wide open. But the other beggar, other poor, who was despised by society, who was looked down and was oppressed, he trusted in you, Lord. Made a promise, a covenant promise with you for the prayer Abrahamic promise, and he was taken up into heaven. Lord God, let everyone, God, know and hear the word of the Lord, that God, it is promised it is unto man once to die, and after that death, because it will come, comes the judgment, and we all have to give an account. Let us all love one another, love the brethren. Let us not, God, allow any group, set one group under another, or put up a bucket master or the whole slave against the field slave, so to speak. Hallelujah. Put up the white, the black middle class, hallelujah, hallelujah, who are the federal government. And yet something many of them vote for a party that is against big government. And they don't realize that is their jobs gonna be slashed. Hallelujah, if you get a smaller government. Is their pension will going to cease? Hallelujah. Not knowing that it's against their very interests. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let them not, God, allow God, one group, hallelujah, to allow them to subjugate and ill-treat the weak, the destitute, the poor, the disabled. Hallelujah. Let us all love one another. Let us all work and labor. Hallelujah. As best as we can to eat our bread. And but those that can't, let us support the feeble and help those Help, Lord Jesus. Send help. God, you said send help into the sanctuary. Strengthen the out of this Zion. Oh, God, help us, I pray. God, Lord, God, as we celebrate Black History Month, let us recognize our history is not just merely in slavery. Because in Africa, most of the blacks were once, hallelujah, part of a dynasty. We were princes and prince and kings and chieftains, tribal chiefs and of dynasties, God, going back from to Egypt and different civilization. Oh God. So let's not think that see ourselves as merely oppressed people that was always oppressed. But let us see ourselves as champions, oh God, who have developed arts and built pyramid with mathematical preciseness. Hallelujah. Bless your people, God. Bless these young people as they celebrate, God, and give their presentation. Bless us everywhere as we say thanks. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We shall overcome. We shall overcome. We shall name. Amen. Amen. Amen.